We'll begin with the lighting of the Advent wreath, which is, as I've said before, a home ritual that we've moved to church to bring that warmth and that community here. We have lit on our prior Sundays the candle for hope and for peace, and our pink candle for joy. And on this last Sunday of Advent, the fourth Sunday of Advent, we light our candle for joy. Or for love, excuse me. Dear Jesus, we pray, may the light of your love always shine in our hearts. As Christmas draws closer, we marvel at your great love for us. Let your love transform every aspect of our lives and touch everyone we encounter. Our hearts are open to you, Jesus.
Amen.
Our worship begins on page 355 of the Book of Common Prayer. Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
Blessed be His kingdom, now and forever. Amen.
We say together the Collect for Purity. Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known. And from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name. Through Christ our Lord.
The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
to the offering of the body of Jesus Christ once for all. The word of the Lord.
Thank you.
When Mary visits her cousin Elizabeth, when they're both expecting, and you see on the cover page of your bulletin a beautiful bronze statue right around the Church of the Visitation, about 20 minutes by car from Jerusalem, where the church has remembered for thousands of years this meeting and this greeting. We hear the moment when the cousins greet each other. When Elizabeth heard Mary's greeting, the child leaped in her womb, and Elizabeth was filled with the Holy Spirit and exclaimed with a loud cry, "Blessed are you among women, and blessed is the fruit of your womb." Elizabeth then wonders how she herself could be so blessed that God's mother has come to visit her. And as soon as Elizabeth hears Mary's voice, she says, "The baby John leaps for joy." So before Mary sings the Magnificat, Elizabeth joins her own belief with Mary's. She says, "Blessed is she," meaning Elizabeth, that there would be a fulfillment of what was spoken to her by the Lord. Not only Mary is blessed, but Elizabeth too. Both women are carrying children who are unlikely for physical, economic, political, cultural, and even religious reasons. God brought surprising abundance into unlikely places. Mary's response to Elizabeth's greeting is drawn from Hannah's great song of joy. Remember Hannah, who bore Samuel after many years of longing for a child. And it's both broadly political and completely, deeply personal. The Magnificat is the proclamation of God's limitless power of liberation and reversal. But I don't know about you, but for me, over time, parts of the Magnificat have been tough to sing. It's easy to rejoice when God fills the hungry with good things, but the parts about scattering the proud in the thoughts of their hearts and bringing down the powerful from their thrones felt a little spiteful, if not short-sighted. Because after all, the mere fact of civil leadership does not necessarily mean injustice or cruelty. And the chaos of toppled governments never brings better things for anybody, not even those who are struggling. Nobody at all, but especially not those who are struggling. And I have trouble singing the part about filling the hungry with good things and sending the rich away empty. That just didn't feel abundant and generous in the way I understand God's economy. After all, I don't think that our God engaged a great plan of surprise and reversal and fulfillment just to make different people hungry and put other people on the top. That's not consistent with the abundant activity of God in the world that I see. So where was Mary in all of this? Was she an innocent teenager, swept up against her will in God's grand plan of salvation, a powerless subject of decisions made for her by others? Maybe, but only for a minute. Mary chose her response to God's invitation, focusing on the many ways in which she was blessed, not on what she lacked according to standards, understandings of the personal or economic power of a young Jewish girl in the first century. Gabriel greets Mary by name, telling her that God is with her, that she's even favored by God. And of course, Mary's not sure about any of this. Luke's gospel tells us that she was greatly troubled by his words and wondered aloud what on earth kind of greeting this was. But she hears him out. She asks good questions. She evaluates Gabriel's answers. And then she says she's all in. "I'm the Lord's servant. Let it be according to your word." In this conversation, though, the ball's still in Mary's court. What if she hadn't been home when Gabriel stopped by? What if she had to wait until the bread was out of the oven, or until she finished up a project of work, or what if she told him she'd have to get back to him Joseph. What if she just said no? I wonder if God had a backup plan for human salvation. But Mary says yes to God through Gabriel, and then she lets loose with this mighty song of joy. The Magnificat is not the song of a victim of force or coercion. The Magnificat is not a song of resignation in the face of inevitable force of empire. The Magnificat is a song of triumph, fulfillment, and reversal. It's not focused on the hard parts, burying the Messiah in poverty under Roman occupation. Mary is rejoicing that God lifted her up and satisfied her hunger with good things. It's the knowing and powerful song of someone who has already entered into partnership with God. Mary doesn't mention the money and the power she doesn't have or her youth and inexperience, but instead she sings of God's favor and great abundance. And the Magnificat has a wonderful relationship and connection to our hopes here at Emmanuel Church as we live into our new lives with Newport Classical and imagine expanding our hopes to include our feeding ministry. St. Martin in the Fields in London is well known both as a concert and a recording venue for great sacred music and as a worshiping community deeply engaged in social outreach. If you ask an American person, especially somebody who grew up in the 60s, 70s, and 80s, about St. Martin in the Fields, if they listen to classical music on NPR or public radio at all, everyone will remember the name Sir Neville Mariner. This concert is conducted by Sir Neville Mariner. And that's how we know it. But in England, St. Martin in the Fields is known as a homeless shelter for the outreach ministry that is done there. I read a 2014 article by Sam Wells, the rector at St. Martin in the Fields, no relation, of course, that relates directly to the Magnificat. I read that this week. And Mary's great choice to live into abundance rather than limits of fear and scarcity. Sam Wells writes about the composer Antonio Vivaldi, who lived from 1678 to 1741 in Venice and wrote one of the great musical settings for the Magnificat. Vivaldi was also a Catholic priest, and he worked, and he was a violinist and a Catholic priest, and he worked as the organist and choir master at a local orphanage that supported its operations through choir performances. And one of those compositions was the Magnificat, Mary's song. So how did the children in the orphanage sing Mary's song? Vivaldi composed music for the choir to perform, drawing audiences in to support the orphanage through donations and bequests. Vivaldi was giving young girls a song to sing and offering them a chance to bring their own redemption about and the liberation of others like them. They were truly singing Mary's song, incubating the gospel of transformation, just as Mary incubated the word. Vivaldi's business plan has a lot in common with the business plan of Emmanuel Church in our space collaboration with Newport Classical. We're serving as a worshiping community, a center for social outreach, and a sacred music venue. And we can live in this dynamic form of social enterprise that begins with celebrating what we do have rather than lamenting our disadvantages. It's a philosophy of abundance, like Mary's own song. And along the way, we'll practice partnership and discipline and teamwork, while remembering that our business sense and our entrepreneurial imagination are just a few things that God has given us to work with as partners with the Holy Spirit in imagining Emmanuel's future. Antonio Vivaldi created a creative partnership among charitable, cultural, and commercial cultures, finding a way to harmonize those sometimes discordant melodies. Those harmonies now can help us hear Mary's song with the great generosity is filled with good things. And who better than Emmanuel Church, the church of the people, to sing Emmanuel's own Mother Mary's song, where everyone does better and no one does worse. In a seaside metaphor more suited to our local context, a rising tide lifts all boats. What if scattering the crowd in the thoughts of their hearts breaks open their hearts and allows them to see others in a new way? And what if God casts down the powerful from their thrones as an invitation to them to join the community? What if Mary's song is about the great generosity of God's economy, where the rich share their resources and go home with lighter pockets, but hearts filled with love and connection? In this Advent season, when we remember both hopeful expectation and penitence, let's ask ourselves new questions about Mary's song and see ourselves and the world in a new way. Standing as you are able, we reaffirm our faith in the words of the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God, the Father of the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten not made. Of one being with the Father, through whom all things were made, for us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary, and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven, and is seated at the right hand. He will come again in glory to judge us living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Revealer of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshipped and glorified. He is so both through God. We believe in the one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life.
Prayers of the People, Form 6, are found in the Book of Common Prayer, page 392. In peace we pray to you, Lord God. On this, the fourth Sunday of Advent, just as Mary obeyed God's call, we pray that you call us to obey, whether that call comes in Holy Ghost whispers or through megaphones. May we listen for God's voice of truth and light. For all people in the daily life of work,
our families, friends, and neighbors, and for this world,
we pray for Joseph, our president, Dan, our governor, Jean Marie, our mayor, kingdom. In the manual cycle of prayer, we pray for the gatherings. For the special needs and concerns of this congregation, we ask your prayers for Janet, Dion, Jill, Ellie, Annie, Ash, Paula, Joan, Matthew, Bill, Vanessa, Julie, Vanda, Natalie, Patrice, Allison, Jeanette, George, Posey, Danny, Russ, Herb, Kate, Lisa, Jeannie, and Jackie's son, Christopher, and Sophia. You may add your own petitions either silently or aloud. Hear us, Lord.
Hear your mercy is great.
We thank you, Lord, for all the blessings of this life. We will exalt you, O God, our King.
We praise your name forever and ever.
We pray for all who have died, that they may have a place in your eternal kingdom. Lord, let your loving kindness be upon them.
Put their trust in you.
We pray to you also for forgiveness of our sins. Have mercy upon us,
Lord Jesus, O God. In your compassion, forgive us our sins.
We got more news last week, and thankfully Emmanuel was already celebrating and worshiping in a conservative manner, so there are very, very few changes to what we need to do now. One of them is that I will keep my mask on, and I know I'm having trouble with my microphone. It turned off today, so I apologize if no one could hear me. But I will keep my mask on, and I will celebrate communion with my mask on. That's the difference. And then there's one more thing, and that is that we won't go to the rail. We'll come right here to a communion station. And I think that's all just wise practice, that we don't bunch up and get so close at the rail. I know this is tiring, everyone, and disappointing, and it's not what we want to hear. I think the good news is that those of us who are vaccinated as much as we can be with boosters and everything are fairly safe from serious illness, but there are breakthrough cases, as you know. I am not a doctor. I don't even play one on TV. So please trust a medical, speak to a medical advisor you trust. But I do urge you to have that conversation if you're not yet boosted. Have that conversation because you'll be safer if you do get boosted. I want to ask everybody, invite everyone to stay after the postlude today for a congregational rehearsal. Randy is going to play, and we're going to practice some Christmas carols that we haven't had a chance to sing. I think I'm getting the out-of-box warning. Practice some Christmas carols that we haven't had a chance to sing. and you can do some chanting. So that'll be fun for a little bit after the service. Up on my camels. I got to get out of the box to avoid a tip of the camel. You notice how close they're getting to the back of the line. They're going to get there. I'm watching it happen. So I wanted to let all of you know that, and also the schedule for Christmas, right? We've got Christmas. First of all, we have our last Advent evening prayer at 6 p.m. on Wednesday with music. It's a lovely service. I urge you to come. I have really enjoyed that worship experience personally. Second, we have Christmas Eve, 4 p.m. and 8 p.m. with music. And the music begins 30 minutes in advance of each service, so 3:30 and 7:30 will be an organ concert for 30 minutes before the worship starts. On Christmas Day, 10 a.m., here at Emmanuel, we will have a joint worship service with St. John the Evangelist and with Historic Trinity. Father Kevin Beasley of St. John's will be preaching. Please come and support all of us in that and join in with our sister churches. And then Sunday the 26th, one service at 10 a.m. with music. The following Sunday, New Year's Day, one service, 10 a.m. with music. Hope you'll all be here if you're not traveling. We look forward to seeing everybody. Is there anything I missed or any questions anybody has? Welcome to all. So glad to see so many folks here, and especially those who've come over the bridge or from far away to be with us. And hello, all of you at home.
Thank you.
and to make us heirs in him of everlasting life, that when he shall come again in power and great triumph to judge the world, we may without shame or fear rejoice to behold his appearing. Therefore we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name. Supper, he took the cup of wine, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, according to his command, O Father, we remember his death. We proclaim his resurrection. We await his coming, glory. And we offer our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving to you, O Lord of all, presenting to you from your creation this bread and this wine. We pray you, gracious God, to send your Holy Spirit upon these gifts, that they may be the sacrament of the body of Christ and his blood of the new covenant. Unite us to your Son in his sacrifice, that we may be acceptable through him, being sanctified by the Holy Spirit. In the fullness of time, put all things in subjection under your Christ and bring us to that heavenly country where, with Mary and all your saints, we may enter the everlasting heritage of your sons and daughters through Jesus Christ our Lord, the firstborn of all creation, the head of the church, and the author of our salvation. By whom, and with whom, and in whom, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever.
Amen.
Amen. And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not to temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. is your custom, we pray together the post-communion prayer found on page 365 of your Books of Common Prayer. Eternal God, Heavenly Father, you have graciously accepted us as living members of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and you have fed us with spiritual food in the sacrament of his body and blood. Send us now into the world in peace and grant us strength and courage to love and serve you with gladness and singleness of heart through Christ our Lord. Amen. May the blessing of the God of Abraham and Sarah and of our sister Mary and of the Holy Spirit that broods over the earth like a mother broods over her children be with you and remain with you always.
Amen.
Our hymn will be 571, All Who Love and Serve, hymn 571.